What shows have I been in that maybe you don't know? 2 and a Half Men with Charlie Sheen. You've seen me in David Spade, Rules of Engagement. Skeet Ulrich and I occurred on CSI New York with Gary Sinise. Beverly Hills 90210 is a series regular. You didn't watch the last season, did you? I was on a show called In the Game. It was a pilot with Jennifer Love Hewitt and Ed O'Neill. And guess who the guest star was? Tom Brady. And we totally hit it off, and he signed footballs for me. Football he gave me said, thank you so much for your help. That's the one that you didn't know. Gotcha.
Then.
Oh, everybody, welcome to my podcast. This is an ADHD show. So, you have it as well?
Oh, yeah.
This is a great show.
But of course, I'm very excited today. I'm always very excited. Don't say a word. I know you're excited also. You're excited to be here. We're shooting this in the evening. This is the first time ever. So I'm excited because I have a quadruple threat, not just a triple threat, a quadruple threat. I have somebody here that is an actor, a producer, a writer, a director. He has 3 movies coming out this month, which is insane. I'd like you to welcome the quadruple threat, David Lipper.
Thank the audience.
You guys, we have a former child actor. How old were you?
My mother put me in the church choir production of The Gondoliers at the St. Matthias Church across the street from the synagogue
that I went to.
In Montreal, where I grew up.
Oh, you're Canadian, I forgot.
Yeah, I did that when I was 8.
No wonder you're so nice and patient.
Yes.
Okay.
We're patient people, the Canadians.
He's a very patient person.
You
should have seen how long it took me to set up today. And he's just like, it's okay. I'm just going to take it. Okay.
Yeah.
So Canada. Where in Canada?
Montreal.
Oh, Montreal.
Yeah.
Oh, nice. It's the city of romance, isn't it?
It's a city of a lot of things. Formula One in June, the Jazz Fest in July, Just for Laughs Festival in August. A lot going on in the summer. Don't go in the winter.
And yet you live here. Why?
Well, this little thing called the entertainment business.
You love producing.
You know.
You were producing all while I was setting up. The steam was coming out of your head.
Somehow making 3 movies at the same time.
Stressful?
Yeah, a little stressful.
Blood pressure. Oh, yeah.
And like you mentioned, 3 movies coming out this month. Murder at Hollow Creek, which I directed with Mickey Rourke, Jason Patrick, Perry Reeves, if you remember
from
Entourage. And Mickey Rourke, still alive.
So talented, huh?
He was the man back in the day, that's for sure.
But I mean, The Wrestler just killed me. Amazing.
Great movie. And Jack Kessy, who's the new Hellboy.
Oh.
He's got one of the leads in this, and I'm very grateful I got to direct this film.
Wow.
So we shot this in Mississippi, and it got released August 3rd.
Was Casper in that?
Casper Van Dien.
Casper Van
Dien. Also in it. Good friend of mine.
He played my brother in Titans.
Love it.
I used to do his hair.
No kidding.
His hair people got me on. He's
the
nicest guy in the world.
Yeah.
But wait, I wanted to go. That's
so
awesome.
That came out. Yeah.
That
and then Crescent City, which you mentioned, actually just got released August 16th.
Ah, okay.
And
super talented cast.
You know, I was the lead producer on that as well. And then Place of Bones, which is really a big production for Latigo Films, which is my film company, with Heather Graham in the lead, Tom Hopper as the villain. Also with the big MMA story.
Corey Nevick is sick in that movie.
Yeah, he's so
good.
He's
so talented.
And Cowboy Donald Cerrone, who can act and is one of the big MMA champions.
Wait, and which one was he?
He was the other bad cowboy, you know, really like Bear John's partner. Named Wilson.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's a real cowboy. He lives on a ranch and shoots guns and rides horses. And so it was really great to have an authentic cowboy there.
Yeah.
And it's a really nice crossover, I think, into the horror genre with this film. You know, so
it was a surprise.
Well, there's a surprise ending.
A surprise.
We're not going to give away. But,
I'm not.
But, you know, the way Paramount wanted us to market it was really to cross over that it also feels horror as well as Western.
Mm.
And... you know, it's terrifying that you have this woman who's a mom and her daughter that she's trying to raise in the middle of nowhere in this desolate mountain in California, where we shot it next to Magic Mountain.
It's in Florida, right? Oh,
Castaic.
Okay.
Which is right by.
That was crazy. I didn't know that. Which is good.
And
for
we
you.
Had rain. It was December and January that we shot, so it was like 1 day of rain, 1 day of shoot, 2 days of rain, 1 day of shoot, 3 days of rain, 1 day of shoot.
How long was the shoot?
It was,
or how many days
of
shooting?
It spanned. We were supposed to finish by Christmas, and we ended up having to stop and coming back after New Year's.
But how many days were you planning on?
I think in actual shoot days, we had 15.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yeah. It was tough. Because we lost so many days, we had no choice. We had to
and
get
Heather
it done
was quickly. Saying how cold it was. It's so funny.
It gets cold in California, especially in the mountains.
Dude,
you know?
It's so cold in those houses.
I know. I was running to Walmart getting Hot Pockets. I'm like, give me more Hot Pockets.
God, oh my God.
And literally, I'm like, I'll buy all the ones you got.
Oh my God.
And I was handing them to everybody. And we had our little fires everywhere, and it just, because at night it got really cold.
Oh,
yeah. The day was fine.
Oh, it totally does.
Nighttime
was bad.
Yeah.
So, okay, so that's that. So people can see, all these movies, wherever. They can just Google it, guys.
They're all on, all the platforms. Mm-hmm. It releases in theaters August 23rd, Place of Bones. And then goes right
past.
To VOD.
That's already, so.
And then the other two are already on VOD, already had their little theater runs. So.
Yeah. God, I want to see more of Terrence Howard.
He's great.
He's
he's really an actor.
Too.
Yeah.
He really is.
And he takes it very seriously. Isai is great too. And by the way, Alec Baldwin crushed it. You know, he comes in.
He's so funny.
And it's like, okay, he's the man. You know, he just
what
takes
the presence
control.
That guy must have.
It's
I
unbelievable.
Can feel it, right? Yeah.
You know, for him to play the captain of the police force, you know, schooling Isai Morales and Terrence Howard, it's like you need somebody with that much gravitas to be able to do it. He comes in, everyone's just like,
you're
boss.
Oh, you can feel it.
Yeah.
You feel it.
Yeah.
Yeah, they were all really, they didn't phone it in at all.
No.
They really were working there.
And I got to tell you, directing Jason Patrick in Murder on Hollow Creek, he is such a talented actor. Mm-hmm. And I remember growing up watching him in Rush, if you remember that movie where he played an undercover cop who was being a heroin addict. He was just off the charts. And I remember thinking, this guy's great. I mean, all the way to Lost Boys, he was great.
Wow.
But he was such a big star in the 80s. Mm-hmm. And remember he did Speed 2, replace Keanu Reeves?
I didn't see it, but I did hear about that. Yeah.
And I think whatever happened with that, it wasn't a huge hit. I don't know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
But let's just say everyone kind of has the same reaction. Like, such a talented actor, so good, was destined to be this huge star,
mm-hmm.
and was
mm-hmm.
for a bit there.
Mm-hmm.
And then... you know, I get the opportunity to work with him
nice.
in a smaller movie because, the way this business works. And I got to tell you, the business has been super unkind right now to older, aging actors. It's not just women anymore. It used to be, right?
Women hit a certain age. Yeah.
See you later.
So
but the
men
could
too,
keep going.
Huh?
But the value
Why?
On all the older guys who used to be worth a lot of money for what they used to call stunt casting. They'd come in for 3-4 days.
Yeah.
That system's dead.
What?
The public's just saying we're not paying for that anymore.
You're kidding.
No.
Why do you think that is?
I think like anything, we beat things to death. We do it over and over and over again, and people just get sick of it and tired of it. And I think with all the streaming options and channels out there,
mm-hmm.
there's just been a flood of B-movie, lower budget content,
mm-hmm.
and I think people just got sick of it. And so you really just got to make a great movie today for an audience to want to shell out the money. And certainly, or just have like really big stars, that they'll come out to see. But you cannot make these big movies anymore. Like those days are over.
Uh-huh. That's right. I've heard that.
Or you got to make them for so little money.
Right.
It's going to be terrible.
But I always wonder if it's because just looking at society as a whole, if people are just so narcissistic now that's why they're, I have no idea if that has anything to do with it at all. Probably not. But I don't know. I just
I
kind
think
of wonder.
Also the younger generation, like doesn't
I'm just
these
thinking that
are.
They don't understand, they don't care about, no one's an artist anymore. I don't know. No one sort of is, I just sort of think that people aren't as deep as they used to be. No one really reads anymore. No one reads plays. No one cares about really great, I mean, I think people don't really care about great movies. It's more about action and, you know, that kind of thing.
I mean, action movies still do great, but at the end of the day, I think you make a great movie and people will come to it. You know, if you build it, they will come.
Yeah, I hope you're right.
Yeah, I believe that.
Yeah. So as a kid, so I wanted to hear about you as an actor. So you were how old?
So I was 8 when I did The Gondoliers. I was 9 when I did Samson the Sun. And I ended up in this theater group that normally, I think the age was 13 and over. And they brought me in at 9.
A theater company?
Yeah.
For plays?
For plays. And I was a musical theater guy. I could really, back then, before puberty.
Are you serious?
I could hit, like, any note. So.
You sang?
I did. Well, I sang on Full House.
I don't know. What do you think? I watched it? No, no. I know you were on it,
so,
but I didn't know
music
that
was,
you
I got a degree
sang.
I got a degree in musical theater. So I was,
God.
Singing musicals. That was, like, my thing. And varsity hockey, which made no sense. But, yeah, so I started doing
lots
musicals.
Lots of injuries. Apparently.
Yeah, luckily, not so many.
I thought you had some injuries from hockey.
I get, like, sore and little things.
Oh, that's
but,
it? Oh, I thought there were...
Nothing super major that's knocked me out for more than a few weeks, I don't think.
Okay. I don't know why. I thought I heard that.
Yeah.
So you were acting. And
yeah, I was doing musicals, and then I was in bands all through high school. I was in rock bands and won a bunch of Battle of the Bands and things like that. And, you know, I thought, like, I was going to be a rock star at one point. So it was a really natural progression to play the character Viper on Full House, who was a rock star, you know, in Uncle Jesse's band. And that's how I met Candace, DJ on the show, and we became a couple. So that was kind of my arc on Full House. But, yeah, like, music was a huge part. I even put out an album that's
Did
on my
you
website.
Really?
Yeah, davidlipper.com.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Wait, but see, I knew you were recurring, but how many did you do approximately?
5.
Okay. Yeah. And then.
Or recorded 5. I don't know.
I mean.
And yeah, okay. And then they brought me back for 2 on Fuller House.
Oh, that's for. I just heard that as well. That's really funny.
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's so weird.
Yeah, they're like the show's back. I'm like,
what
show? They're like Fuller House. I'm like, what?
All the reboots. So weird.
Yeah.
Weird.
And the shit still, like, I still get residuals on Full House. Like, it still runs. People know the show. They watch it. Like, new kids.
Watch the
show from 19... I was on 1994, 1995. Those were my years. Yeah.
Okay, so you were doing that show, and then...
Yeah, I mean, I was a sitcom guy. Once I got to L.A.
When did Leslie Moonves... You say Les, I say Leslie. Leslie Moonves said about David... Go ahead, say what he said.
I think it was something along the lines, as long as I'm president of Warner Brothers Television, you'll have a job here. And then he got the job of president of CBS, and I don't think I ever worked for him again.
That's the story of our business.
But he was great. He, you know, kind of discovered me. My first audition in L.A., I was here for 2 weeks. I knew a guy who knew a guy.
Oh.
Got me a pre-read.
Nice.
With a casting director for a show called Step by Step with Suzanne Summers and
yeah.
Patrick Duffy.
Yeah.
And I got all the way down to the final 2.
For series regular?
Yeah.
Nice.
For,
oh my God.
Unfortunately, it went to a guy named Sasha Mitchell.
Oh yeah. Interesting.
But it was down to the wire. Like, they took them a few days. Normally they decide in the room, you know, who they're casting for a pilot. But this was already, it's already went to series. And so they really knocked it around for a few days. It was close, but that was my 2nd week.
That is ridiculous.
So I just thought, well, this is going to be easy. And
everybody thinks that when they come here.
I'm like, okay, cool. They know I'm here.
Yeah.
And then I got a really good agent right away, Bonnie Leike, at Gold Leike, which then became Talent Works.
Oh, yeah.
And still is today.
Uh-huh.
And
she's still there?
She's a manager now. Yeah, really good manager.
Oh, yeah?
She was at William Morris Endeavor before, and then became a manager. So, but yeah, she was an awesome, awesome agent, and that was kind of the beginning. And then it was like, who's this kid from Canada?
Yeah.
And I booked a pilot the next year. It was a Kaufman Bright Crane pilot. It was the other pilot they made when they made Friends, and my co-stars were it was with Giovanni Ribisi, Hilary Swank.
And
Tiffany Thiessen played my girlfriend.
Oh, this is an unaired pilot.
It was a pilot that didn't make it. And Kaylee Coco was my little sister.
Ah, funny.
And they all went on to huge careers.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I was the star of the show. Number one on the call sheet.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Wow.
And it's on YouTube. If you want to just type in David Lipper reality check. And I got to work with Bob Denver, who played Gilligan from Gilligan's Island.
Oh, my God.
Right before he died. It was the last thing he shot before he died. And it was a flashback scene I had where a dream sequence where I'm sitting next to Gilligan on a bench.
Oh my God.
It was really cool. It was like the best show I ever did. And I thought, okay, here we go. I'm going to be a huge star. This is going to be a huge show. And they picked it up for like a month. And then they pulled it when they got the rights to football. And some genius at Fox went, well, we got football. We need a sports show. And it was Sunday. They had the Sunday football, and this was Sunday between The Simpsons and Married with Children, so they wanted a sports show. Great idea.
Well,
and then Friends became the biggest hit ever.
Yes.
And I remember the Fox executives at the time. I tested for a pilot the next year there, and they're like, "We messed up so bad. We should have."
They always, you always end up hearing that later on, like, "Oops,
oopsie,
we really should have."
Yeah.
You're talking about a sports show. I did one with Tom Brady, actually, and Ed O'Neill, and it was an unaired pilot, and Jennifer Love Hewitt. Same kind of thing, but the opposite of yours. Ours was a sports show. The woman who was president at the time was like, no, we're not doing that. We're not doing it, and she left. And it was he went on to do Modern Family, whatever.
Little show ran 20 years.
But that would have been Tom Brady and I became, like, not fast friends, but then... That was the end of that. But he signed some footballs and stuff and said, thank you for your help. He was really nervous.
I have a whole bunch of pilot tapes that never made it to air.
Do you?
Oh, yeah. I shot a series. We shot 26 episodes, never aired.
What?
Yeah. It was for Fox Family, and they sold the network to ABC, became ABC Family, and the show got lost in the sale.
That's so weird when people do that. And they always say, oh, yeah, we made a mistake.
And I, once again, number one on the call sheet.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's tough. The TV was really tough in those days because, you know, they had so much money. The business changed.
But it's tough now.
Yes.
It's insane.
But what's different now is they would make like 25 half-hour and 25 one-hour pilots for a network, and they have like a few slots, and that's it.
Yeah.
Now they're very selective on the money they spend.
Let's just do what we already have.
Yeah.
Let's just bring it back.
Yeah.
Let's
keep
it going.
The odds of your show getting on the air were bad in those days. Today they're much better. Problem now is just, no one wants to pay any money. The ad revenue is so low because there's so many channels, there's so many options, it's hard to get a big share of the audience. So the business is shifting. There's like a major shift happening right now. DVDs are gone. Right, so Redbox went bye-bye.
Well, yeah.
That was a huge revenue stream for independent film producers like me.
Mm-hmm.
These days, the TV sales that used to be a part of films are gone. And there's so many streamers and so many outlets now that they're paying so much less than they used to pay. So
the non-union is a huge...
Inflation went up, right?
Mm-hmm.
Cost of goods, food...
I don't know, it depends who you listen to. Is inflation up or...
Inflation's a disaster. I mean,
it depends who you talk to. Some people say there's no inflation.
Well, put it this way. Let's say I had a caterer.
I'm not saying that I'm saying that. I'm just saying some people say that.
I don't know who's saying that, but I can just tell you that.
Well, it depends.
Like minimum wage when I started was $5 an hour, is now $20 an hour here in LA for certain places. I mean, so
I'm not
labor's
saying
up,
that,
food
ways.
Is up.
Yeah,
all these
everything,
costs
of course.
But the sales are down. So imagine if it cost you $1 million to make a movie 5 years ago, right? That same movie today would cost you $2 million. But the sales on that million 5 years ago were probably $2 million, $3 million, $4 million. And now you can barely get that million back. That's kind of the reality of what we're living on. So you gotta be super creative with brand integration, with tax credits and rebates, and find ways to make a dollar stretch. And while all that happened, the strike happened, so actor rates went up, the WGA strike happened, writing fees went up, the DGA strike happened, DGA numbers went up, and nobody really understands that all these costs have gone up, revenue's gone down, and they've put the business in a real pickle, so a lot of companies are going bankrupt.
Yeah.
And you're gonna see a major shift, a lot of consolidating, even between the streamers, like a lot of the streamers have had trouble. So everybody's feeling it right now. Mm-hmm. It's the most tense I've ever seen Hollywood in the 32 years I've been here. It's, you know, and so it's weird because on the one hand, this sounds really negative, but on the other, it's going to cause a correction. It's going to weed out a lot of bad content creators.
It's just like real estate.
Yeah.
Same thing.
And you're going to have now a better selection of quality programming, and I think you're going to see a shift. You're going to see consolidation. You're seeing things like Paramount now selling. You saw Fox and Disney merge. These are the kinds of major moments we're going to see continuing. So, and all this has been a learning experience for me. I was just an actor who had to learn the business side of the biz.
So when you were acting, what happened? When did you start writing next after acting?
Yeah, that's exactly what happened.
Yeah.
I wrote
Where
Christmas.
Did you learn how to write?
I bought a couple of books. I bought a great book called The Writer's Journey that's based on The Hero's Journey by Joseph Campbell.
Mm-hmm.
I really like that to explain the progression of how not only a hero goes from A to Z, but the archetypes he comes along in contact with
mm-hmm.
along the way. I loved McKee's story
uh-huh.
Structurally. It's funny, when I wrote my Christmas movie that aired last Christmas Eve on MTV and did really well.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's called The Christmas Letter. I remember I was like at right around page 70 and I got stuck. And I said, I know there's a major event that has to happen here and I don't know what it is. I grabbed the book. And I think it said something like, right around page 70, your hero should come to a fork in the road.
Uh-huh.
Should he go right? Should he go left? And the direction he picks is why he earns his destiny at the end of the movie. And that was a huge moment in this movie for me, where I planted this Dear Santa letter at the beginning of the movie that ends up in the pocket of this mailman, and he finally opens this letter at that moment and realizes he's making the biggest mistake of his life and turns the car around and goes after the family that he loves. And there was a lot of emotional stuff I was going through that I put on the page in this movie.
Mm.
It was a really nice opportunity for me to tackle some subjects in a metaphorical way and make a really nice Christmas movie out of it. Mm. And it was a struggle. It took me 15 years to get that movie made. It got optioned 3 times by 3 different producers.
Hmm.
None of whom could make it. And
why?
Then I was...
Why did they say?
I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, one guy...
What did they say?
One guy optioned it, raised a ton of money on this script, and then pulled the money from the account into another movie and left it in the dust. I mean, this is the kind
of
stuff we
deal. And did it end up on Hallmark?
No.
Where
up TV.
Oh, sorry. Oh, up TV.
Yeah. And it aired primetime Christmas Eve, which was like the most coveted time slot. And we made like 5 top 10 lists. Yeah, it was amazing. And one of the things that kept popping up in all these top 10 lists is that it was so refreshing to see a Christmas movie that wasn't just a straight rom-com of boy meets girl, boy loses girl,
boy gets girl
back, or vice versa. Mm. But we brought in the kids and the family in a sense of how important family is. And that's something I've wrestled with because I've been single for a very long time. You know, I mean, I've had girlfriends come and go, but I've never been married. I've never had kids. And so I think it was a nice way for me to express how even though I don't have a family, it's still a really important thing for me. And it's not something I've not done intentionally. It's just the way things go. You know, work has kind of taken over my life, and it's not always the most conducive thing to having a great relationship. So, you know, we're married to the job, really, as actors, writers, directors, producers, and all of the above put together. So it's just 4 times the work and 4 times, you know, what we go through. But it was really rewarding to see this movie come to life. I shot it during lockdown, which was crazy in Canada. I couldn't even get people there. I had to drive over the border from Michigan because you couldn't fly in, because they had a COVID hotel at Toronto's Pearson Airport where you had to quarantine for two weeks.
Yeah.
You couldn't just like connect and get to the place.
What a crazy
crazy time. I couldn't even get catering. Yeah, so in Toronto they quarantine you in this COVID hotel for 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And there's no way to bring in cast and put them in a hotel for 2 weeks before they can come to set. So we had to cast everybody in the province of Ontario, basically. Because they also had a provincial lockdown. Like, you couldn't even go, I think, from province to province. It was crazy. As bad as it was here, it was worse in Canada.
Wow.
Yeah, just think, like, of all the lockdown stuff you went through. And by the way, I flew there in April of 21. We already had the vaccine. It came out, you know, March, April. Like, we were all getting our shots. And Canada hadn't gotten the vaccine yet. So they were still in the throes of lockdown.
Oh, wow.
And so for me, they put me, like, I had to call in every day. They had an app, like, traced me.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like, you can't leave the house. We're gonna monitor you for 2 weeks.
You're kidding.
And that was the only way I could avoid the COVID hotels, that I drove over the border and I go directly to a residence. And then they monitored me, and they actually did teleconferences with me. And then they sent, like, they dropped off a package for me to be tested.
Oh, yeah.
And then put it back in the package and, like, tested me throughout my stay.
It was weird.
It was a wacky time.
It was very weird.
So, but I got that movie made, and we really made something special.
Wow.
And,
Who was in it?
Glenda Braganza played my love interest, Roger Cross, who's amazing.
You said these Canadian actors?
All Canadians.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No wonder I wasn't in it. Okay,
yeah,
makes sense.
All Canadians. All Canadians, and even me. I'm a Canadian.
I picked that up.
Yeah. And we shot it in the town of Sault Ste. Marie, which is spelled Sault Ste. Marie, but it's pronounced Sault Ste. Marie.
Oh, okay.
And it actually played Sault Ste. Marie for Sault Ste. Marie, because the kids drive from Michigan to Canada to find Santa. Because Santa's in Canada.
Okay.
In the north.
Oh,
yeah.
Good to know.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll go
on North
there
Pole
this
Road.
Christmas. That's cute.
Yeah.
Very cute.
And Colin Mochrie played Santa. He was great. From Whose Line Is It Anyway? Really funny comedian.
Oh.
Yeah.
Wow, that's
really
awesome.
Nice cast.
My God.
Yeah.
I just might have to see that.
You should. It's a great movie.
But that's so nice that it was so personal to you like that.
Really personal. Yeah.
I love that. Wow.
And so that was, producing was all about finding a platform for me to be creative, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't like I wanted to be a producer. I just wanted to make the
Let's
movie.
Let's make things.
And if nobody else was going to make it,
right.
I was going to make it. And that just kept happening.
You know what's so neat, David? You know how you love eyelashes, right?
I love eyelashes?
Yeah. Aren't these the ones that you wear? Or these?
I just have natural eyelashes.
You do? Who wants natural eyelashes?
Oh, my God.
You can have Prism and Brazil.
Yeah.
I'm wearing Brazil, but if I want to audition for something where I'm not wearing any glamour stuff, I do Prism. You know who makes these?
Brazil.
No. Lilac Street.
Right, Reboot Camp, same thing. I starred in the movie. A friend of mine wrote it and directed it. I got to do a lot of improv.
So wait a minute. So what you wrote, so you were acting, then you wrote the script.
Yeah.
Then, and how did you learn how to produce?
I did it on a movie called The Unwilling. It's a horror movie I did with Jonathan Heap, who directed it.
Yeah. Oh.
We wrote the script together with our friend Philip. We just kind of sat down together and brainstormed ideas, and Jonathan said, I'll direct, you star in it. So I called the lead guy David. I picked names of characters that I could remember. It's funny. So my cousin's name is Michelle. I made my sister, who was played by Dina Meyer, Michelle. Darren is a friend of mine, so I made the cousin Darren, and I was just like, that's how I put it all together. So because when you're writing, it's hard to remember who's who unless you kind of put a face
to
the character.
Yeah.
So if I could put a person I know's face on the character, it's easy for you to remember who I'm talking about, and have some kind of archetype. Of the person. So that movie was amazing. We shot it in 2015, 2016. And I had to learn how to produce a movie, you know, and I did. From the finance raise all the way through production to post.
How did you learn?
I learned on the ground. I mean, look, I've been on...
Did you ask people questions?
Well, I've been doing that my whole life as an actor, right? I always befriended the producers. I always wanted to learn.
Oh, I never did that. So okay.
I did. I mean, I grew up in a business
house,
right? My dad created two factories from nothing and taught me how to read a balance sheet.
No, that's amazing. The fact that you did that is... complete opposite of what I did.
Yeah, no, I that's great. You know, two MBAs in my family.
No, that's amazing.
You know, taught me.
Yeah.
And okay. And I learned. You know, I learned. I knew. You know,
wow.
I speak math, so you know, I just figured it out. And
uh-huh.
We made a bunch of low budget movies. I mean, Reboot Camp. I'm really proud of. We won the Austin Film Festival Best Comedy.
How did I not see this?
That's like my favorite.
Have I seen that?
That's my favorite performance of anything I've done. So
do you know if I saw it?
I don't know.
Okay.
We had an outdoor premiere back when COVID was happening.
Oh, God, I can't remember.
Because we made the movie in 2019 and we released it during COVID, you know, which was tough to release a movie then. But,
okay. I know the name of it.
We did an outdoor theater premiere because of COVID.
Wow. Okay.
And it went, you know, it was an amazing movie. And people said, hey, we saw you produce this movie. We got a script. Do you want to make this movie? And it just kind of kept happening. And I shot all through COVID. And really where it changed was Deathlink in 2020. March of 2020 was the first movie I ever directed.
Okay.
And I saw that, you know, having worked with a lot of directors,
mm-hmm.
Maybe I know a little bit more about directing than I thought.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe I should give this a,
mm-hmm.
a crack. And the writer saw me workshopping the scenes in an acting class I used to teach and said, why aren't you directing this movie?
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, okay, maybe I will.
Yeah.
And then I did. And then a pandemic broke out in the middle of the shoot and I lost half my crew and I lost half my cast and I had to go from 16 days to 11 days.
Uh-huh.
And I got it done, you know, but then I went, hey, I can shoot in a pandemic. So I kept shooting. Mm-hmm. And people kept coming to me saying, we heard you're shooting. Can we shoot with you? And we made Just Swipe with Jody Sweetin.
Oh.
I called Jody and said, you know, we have the same manager.
Oh.
I said, I'd love you to be my love interest in this. I was the lead once again.
Uh-huh.
And we made a great movie. We shot in 8 days in a house during lockdown.
So crazy.
Yeah. And the big Sinatra estate in Woodland Hills. Yeah, but the Sinatra estate's so big and there's so many different rooms that look like different places
yeah.
that we were really able to double all these locations.
Mm-hmm. What year was this?
This was 2020. This was November 2020. And then at the very beginning of 2021, I shot Curse of Wolf Mountain, which came out last year. And so that was the second film I directed with Danny Trejo, Tobin Bell,
mm-hmm.
Matt Rife, who became a big star.
My
so
God.
Matt Rife is in every movie I've directed.
Are you serious?
The three movies I've directed, Matt Rife is in all three of them.
Oh my
I just
God.
Kept hiring him saying, I don't know what's wrong with everyone, but this kid's
yeah.
going to be a star, and
yeah.
I don't know why I'm the only one who sees it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I didn't think he was going to be a stand-up star. I thought he was a movie star. Like, he was super good-looking guy, super
mm-hmm.
charming.
So talented.
And really funny.
Yeah.
And to me, you know, I kept saying, what are you doing in these comedy clubs for like 50 bucks a night? Matt,
wow.
I'm putting you in movies. You're going to be a movie star. You're like, no, I got to do the stand-up thing.
Wow.
It's really important to me.
Wow.
I was like, really? Boy, was I wrong. But yeah, he crushed it and now is a huge star. He's selling out. He sold out like five or six nights at Radio City.
Crazy.
And you're just like, nobody sells out.
He works
that
so hard. Oh my God.
And really good with the social media, which I think is one of the things.
That's how I know.
That's what separated him. He's young,
yeah.
good looking.
Yeah.
Some two things you don't see a lot in comics.
And, yeah.
And he's absolutely brilliant with the social media and the
crowd
work, right? The interactive.
So he's so smart.
Really, really.
He's
he found
so
a niche.
Quick.
You know, like all comics do crowd work.
But they're not all good at
well,
all.
And there's
That's,
a lot of good crowd work comics, but the bulk of their routines are their routines. You know, crowd work
yeah.
is a small piece of it.
Yeah.
He made it a bigger piece. And I think such a good looking guy who is so personable to connect with people in the audience, especially a female audience. I think he found magic that that just happens once in a blue moon. Now he's got another hit Netflix special. So anyway, he's in five of my
he's
movies
so
that I produced.
So
all quick. Three of the ones I directed, including Murder Hollow Creek, which just got released. Go watch it on your favorite platform. I'll never be shameless enough to stop plugging. But yeah, so Matt's a big part of all these movies.
That is awesome.
And now, like, can I get him in the next one I'm directing? I don't know. Like, now I'm not even getting my text messages answered. But I mean, in his defense, the guy works like six nights
no,
a week
on
stand-up. So, but really, I just said, I'm just going to keep hiring him until he doesn't take my calls anymore.
Yeah.
Because I knew he was going to be a star.
Yeah.
You know, obviously, that's why I kept putting him in stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, so he's in every movie I directed, including Murder Hall Creek, which came out, and Curse of Wolf Mountain. He's just hysterical. You know, I can't help myself I turned Murder Hollow Creek and Curse of Wolf Mountain, which both were Mike Kelly Bryce, which were not necessarily supposed to be comedies, I turned them both into comedies. And because I said, look, I cast funny people, mm-hmm. I'm going to make it funny. And I'm going to find improv. I'm going to let them do stuff. And I found this kid, Dooley, who played the deputy in, with the deputy of the park rangers in Curse of Wolf Mountain. And I just let him go. I just gave him stuff. I said, pretend you're James Brown. Do this.
Oh,
try this.
God, that's fun.
And I love doing that with cast.
Yeah.
And that's what I got
yeah.
to do at Reboot Camp, which was so amazing. I ad-libbed half the movie. You know, it was a very short script because he wanted... Because it was a mockumentary, right? So with mockumentaries like the Larry David Show or
uh-huh.
you know The Office, you need to do that. You need to have ad libs. You need to have a loose script that
uh-huh.
you can play with. And so I come from that world. I come from the comedy world. I come from the sitcom world. So I think that makes me a really good director when it comes to bringing out comedy. So I turned Murder at Hollow Creek, which was supposed to be just a straight thriller, you know, where
so...
you know this guy gets killed and these kids are affected by it and the cops are trying to solve the murder, and I turned it into a comedy about how absurd Mickey Rourke is as this Serbian mobster.
Oh my god!
And I cast my buddies Jason and Jeremy London as his henchmen, and I just knew everyone was going to be funny.
Oh my god!
But the ones who stole the show were Paul Ben Victor and Penelope Ann Miller. And if you don't know Penelope Ann
wow.
Miller, she was a huge star back
yeah,
in the day. And
yeah,
she's still
yeah.
like unbelievable.
Yeah.
And I just made them the neurotic parents.
Oh my god.
And I was like, go, just get into a fight, let's just go on this. And they were so brilliant. And the only way to do this, by the way, is you gotta shoot cross coverage. Okay?
Yeah.
Because there's no way to recreate
yeah,
these
yeah.
moments. And I
yeah,
learned that
yeah.
on Reboot Camp.
Yeah.
And Ivo taught me that when he directed that film. And he constantly had cross coverage on
that's
the cameras.
So
a lot
nice.
Of DPs don't like to shoot cross coverage,
yeah.
you know, because it's hard to light both directions
yeah.
like this, like you and
yeah,
me at
yeah,
the same
yeah.
time, like we're doing right now.
Yeah.
But that is the way, the only way to do a natural flow where you don't shoot this side,
yeah, yeah,
and then
that's the best.
Shoot this side, and we have to recreate whatever
yeah.
happened on this
yeah.
side. But by shooting cross coverage, we get these magical moments that we don't have to recreate. So,
yeah.
so that's how I did it. And I made sure when I was going to improv, I would do that.
That's so awesome.
Yeah. I mean,
and it makes it
were
so
you at that premiere? I don't remember.
Actors.
We got a lot of laughs at the Beverly Hills Film Fest.
No,
yeah.
I've seen some, I think I've seen, I've
where's
seen,
the hole in this glass?
I've seen a lot.
That's what happens when you're at the bottom of the glass.
I've seen.
By the way, it's 100 degrees
just,
here, so that felt
he's
fantastic.
He's just like, oh.
I gotta tell you, the air's off. So I'm just like.
For noise. Not because
yes.
I'm being mean. You were just trying to do it like you were a sexy girl on a commercial. Just
yeah.
pour it down your face,
the,
down your
the
chest.
The Bud Light commercials I did in the 90s. Just
you in the 90s.
Flashback. I had a great decade.
We keep hearing about the 90s.
Yeah, it was a good time, right? Wasn't it?
Oh, was I
us?
There?
Yeah, you were killing it in the 90s. What are you talking about?
I'm kidding.
Michael Jacobs.
Oh, God.
He was a fan of mine.
He was
you know,
such
I thought
a...
I was...
He was such a beautiful writer.
Really, really talented.
So what
writer.
Did you work with him on?
He wanted me to replace the teacher on Boy Meets World.
Oh, Boy Meets World, okay.
He wanted me to play that character, whatever it was. And I don't remember what happened. I was stuck on another show. And he wanted to develop something with me. Like, he was actually amazing.
He is amazing.
He wanted me to star in a bunch of stuff for him. And for whatever reason, it just never worked out, but... He was one of my fans, I think,
yeah, yeah.
and I will forever be grateful that
he
said so many nice things about me, and one of the most successful writers. Don't forget, he had not only like that show, and the Joey Duncan, Jay, I don't know the four name show, but he did I think the Dinosaur Show, right? That was his show with the puppets.
We did an unaired pilot together. And that was about the dinosaur days, but it was called the Oog Show,
the
not
Oog?
The Oog Show.
No,
and then they called it.
I think this was called Dinosaurs or something.
I wonder if it was after, right
90s.
After Charles in Charge. I did this, so well then maybe.
But
maybe
he had a whole bunch of shows that did really really well. So
I forgot about it until you just we're talking about it now. That's interesting.
So many good sitcoms in the 90s, but here's the funny thing: not a lot of them known today. And this is what shocked me the most about Full House, but Full House, everybody still knows the show. everybody I know has kids, and my kids watch the show, and I'm just like, really? Like, they're like, of all the new shows and everything out there, they're still watching Full House. And he's like,
is
we're
it
still
on?
Full House? Still on.
Oh, I didn't know. I thought it, okay.
They have been rerunning this show nonstop.
But I mean, rerunning, but are they still making the new one, reboot?
No.
Oh, that's
reboot.
What I thought you
yeah.
meant.
No, I
oh,
mean.
Oh, the reruns.
I mean, they're still rerunning
oh,
the show.
Wow.
And like Netflix,
but,
you know, has had it.
What channel was it originally on?
ABC.
Oh, see, you were lucky.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't make Jack on the residuals, like 0 cents.
Oh, God, I'm still getting checks.
Literally, well, so am I for 1 cent, 0 cents. Like, it's not a check, it just says you made 0 cents on this, and 1 cent, and 2 cents.
That those are my distribution checks that I get from Gravitas. They send me these checks for $0.
Well, it's Gravitas.
I've had 5 of those.
Sorry.
I'm like,
I shouldn't say that.
Is there a reason you sent me a check for 0.00? Welcome to our business. Yeah.
Yeah, totally weird. But anyway, okay. So, God, I think you answered all those questions about directing and.
I mean, that's how I progressed
into
all these things, and then finally, what happened is I made 5 movies during COVID.
I can't believe it. Did I know you then?
You've known me for a long time. Yeah.
Why have we never worked together? I'm starting to hear all your credits. I'm like, well, shouldn't I have been in those things? I'm sure the audience is thinking the same thing. What's that?
You know,
that?
We ended up.
What is that?
On Curse of Wolf Mountain, I ended up with Latinas as the family. So it was just
two
sisters.
By the way, I always love when I ask a friend, like, why haven't we worked together? And then he goes, Latina.
Well, so.
It's shooting in China.
So what happened was I got
Malibu.
Everyone's
a man. We're non-union.
By the way, I shot 2 movies in China. That's a true story.
Okay,
so.
Everyone's a man. That's another one I've gotten.
Yes, that you're still a woman.
Unless you
want to
play
I've seen.
A war, you know.
Right. It's like, you know, like, why did I play that character? Well,
Mark
Klebanoff, she's the sister of a Latino famous pop star that we cast. So Malu Trevejo, who's, I think, got 30 or 40 million followers on Instagram and TikTok, she, and a hit song, or several hit songs, she was somebody I cast in the movie, and then the only other woman that I could cast was, to play my wife, was the,
an older woman.
Was a Latina woman.
I was too young.
No, you could have played my wife.
Oh, I could have?
Yeah.
I could have played your wife?
Sure.
Oh, I thought that you were so much older than I was and everything. I thought that maybe I'd be too young to play your... Do
well,
I look like I could play his wife?
I play younger on television.
I'm just kidding. So your wife was who?
Fernanda
Latina?
Romero. Yeah.
Oh, Latina. Oh,
yeah,
we're still on the Latina thing. Okay, and then
yeah.
What was the next one after that? I love to... I'm grilling him now. This is hilarious. Okay, what was the next one?
The third one I directed? Murder in Hollow Creek?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's where I mean...
Was there a female... Was that the...
Penelope Ann Miller.
Oh, you know what?
But she's older.
I just auditioned for something where she played some mom, and she got it, and I didn't get it. But I'm like, of course, that makes sense. She's a big name. Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
She's also older.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So she played a mom. Anyway, okay.
And then Jessica Lord played the female. She's like 20. She was 21, I think.
That's it?
Yeah, because they were supposed to just...
What other? And then
they're college graduates. So all the girls were 21.
Oh.
And then...
Oh,
the
yeah,
mom.
Yeah.
So, awesome. Yeah.
Okay.
So.
What about next? You know what? If I'm not going to call and ask
there's
you
Liam
this,
Neeson's
might...
wife, but I think you're too young for that.
No, I'm not.
Okay, you want to? Do you think you're too young to play my wife?
I'm
and the guy is 25 years older than me. You
I'm
want to
making
play...
a joke.
You want to play his wife?
Who? How old is he?
He's in his 70s.
Hey, I love older men.
Really?
I'm kidding. Is okay. It supposed to be a? Is she using him for his money? Then we could pull it off. I not that
so
I'm not like that.
His loving
life.
Wife. Who
oh, it's
has...
a loving wife. So she needs to be in her. 60s?
Well, older than you.
Or 70, okay. I could pull off 70 with makeup.
Even
and
60 would be significantly younger
I could pull makeup
than
and...
Him.
Okay. I'm kidding. Okay. What about after that? You said you're doing 3?
I'll let you know when the other deal's close.
I mean, the drama just makes me want to step right into it. Listening to your phone calls. In fact,
a lot of drama.
I should represent you on that because that pisses me off. And we're not going to get into all this stuff. I kind of feel like I should. Can I say any of this stuff?
Let's
we're
just
not
say,
saying
you know,
can I?
The,
can I?
The finance side of the movie business is really tough.
I think I need to be your pit bull.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll be your mouthpiece for this.
I'm
kind
a, of it's tough because I'm a very nice guy.
I know you're nice,
and
I'm a really mean.
And I deal with a lot of tough.
Yeah.
Not so nice people.
If it pisses me off in a business situation, not the acting business, but if it's another sort of thing, I am very strong.
You are strong.
People. How would you know? You see me socially. You don't see me.
Well, you're tough. I wouldn't mess with
you. How would you see that?
I can see it.
When?
I wouldn't mess with you.
You wouldn't?
Nope.
Where the hell are you getting that? Is it because I told you I'd lose my shit if someone treated me like that?
Pretty much.
That's it? Okay.
You're going to look pretty with these eyelashes.
What does that mean? Or these, depending. Sitcom?
Brazil.
Film.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. I've got some for you for with your cutoff shirt when you're in West Hollywood.
Because I was really hoping for
some
lashes.
I have
some call.
Was this your phone that you said you turned off?
I put it on.
I
put it, do not disturb.
I turned mine off.
You had an alarm go off.
That's, I know. Yeah. A dating app one. There's a special.
An alarm to be on a dating app.
Well, this reminds me to go check it out because otherwise I left
them
go. You
need a reminder to check?
I don't think about my love life. Do you think about yours?
Well, I see who swiped.
How? You're looking on the app.
Listen, I made a movie called Just Swipe. I'm all about the swipe.
Oh, well, yeah. I don't put attention into it unless I set an alarm.
You gotta put your intention in there.
I also have an alarm to eat because I might forget to eat that early. Yeah, I have an alarm to drink bottle number one, number two, and number three, and number four.
I don't have to set an alarm to eat. I just eat.
I have to... I'm trying to do two... Okay, well, at dinner time, I have to set an alarm. Actually, even for lunch. I'm not thinking about it.
I need more alarms to not eat. Say, oh, this is reminding you not to eat.
Don't eat.
Put it down, David. Put the Snickers down.
Oh, Snickers. That shouldn't even be in your place.
It's not.
Now, let's get into Trader Joe's, shall we? The audience knows. A lot of people know. I'm a big Trader Joe's fan.
Who's not?
Well, there are people that aren't.
What?
But I'll tell you right now, I know some of the best desserts there. David, there is...
The key lime pie is one of my faves. I always make sure when that's in season in the frozen section.
Oh, I didn't even know it, really.
What?
Okay.
You've never had the key lime pie?
No, I haven't. At Soho House, they used to have one that was like this.
I've had it.
Oh, they got rid of it. Now they only have the mess.
The what?
The mess. It's from
the
England.
Mess. Was that the... Oh,
they have
the, what about the
also.
Tofu, this sticky toffee pudding?
Oh, that? Oh, God, that stuff is so ridiculous. So yeah, it's good. No, but everybody knows that I'm obsessed with, and I'll show it to you. I have a whole social media thing where I did sometimes I alternate podcasts with me doing them alone, and then I alternate with guests, and I do, because the whole thing I did start in 2016 was questions and answers sort of thing where I was trying to help people that were being bullied. That was the whole purpose for basically I did everything like this, and I tried to help people. And that's why I started it. I was helping people.
Excellent.
They emailed, you have no idea how much you help with my situation. And I don't tell people what to do. I just was sort of sharing my life experience and see if that can help. Then I thought, I'm going to bring it back now in 2000. It was 23. But then I thought, well, I'll just do it like a podcast instead.
By the way, that was Reboot Camp. I would just talk to people and help them. And then this is what happened, except I did it like this, like I was from French Canada.
Oh,
and just put
I
on a
dated
character.
Five Canadians.
Oh, there you go.
Which is hilarious. Okay.
I created a fake guru, and my brother was documenting it to show how easy it is to manipulate people and thinking you're like some great genius when you just have to listen to people and say a few things and they think you're brilliant. And so that was kind of the premise, except the problem was it became so successful. And next thing you know, all these celebrities and reality stars, everyone started coming to the camp, mm-hmm. the Reboot Camp, to study with me, Gordon Saint-Pierre. And Jarul came, and David Koechner from The Office came, and Ed Begley. And now I started believing my own hype. And I think that's what happens in all these cults, right? I think that it starts with a good intention.
Well,
I want to help people.
I didn't do a cult.
And what?
I never was a cult. I was truly trying to help.
I'm just saying, because the movie got into...
We got off the whole dessert. We're not talking about the dessert anymore.
No, I was talking about a cult.
But after this, go ahead with the cult. Okay.
Yes. So I'm saying the Reboot Camp started as this nice thing, and it turned into a cult. And I think that's what happens. You know, the road to hell was paved with good intentions.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's like, I think, legitimately, a lot of these people started with good intentions, and then, you know, power corrupts, and you start believing your own hype. And that's what happens, like with anything. And that's where I think all these self-help people have gotten to these places where all of a sudden they become cults.
Oh my God.
Yeah, so all that's in the movie, by the way.
Is that where I'm headed?
No.
cult?
I just
paid with good intentions.
I just took what you said
what
and found it. I found an opportunity to replug my movie. You see what I did there? It's like I just
did. I not know. I was thinking to myself, the actor is back. The lipper is the
shameless
back.
Plugger.
Okay, so my point is, I was actually trying to help people, and so I do the questions and answers where I alternate. I'm by myself, right?
Right.
Answering some people's questions. Some of them I say, please go to a therapist instead because I can't do it.
Yes.
Don't let your eyes glaze over this. This is very exciting.
Sorry, what?
Instead of ice cream, they have this thing. I'll show you. I tried to just eat a little bit in front of the audience. I could not stop. It was a little embarrassing. I just said, just try a little bit. And then I kind of like went, oh my God. I couldn't stop eating it. It's gelato. It's chocolate and like white vanilla gelato. And it tastes like whipped cream is like infusing, like puffed into this.
I don't know how we got on the subject, but
it's so exciting.
Yeah.
You've gotta, I'll show it to you. I can't stop eating it. It's actually really fun.
I could go for some ice cream because did I mention it's about 100 degrees
really
in here?
It's really hot in here.
Yeah.
Please, you know what he's gonna do? You know what he's gonna do? He's gonna take his shirt off because he likes to do that at parties.
A pool party when I'm
going in the
swimming pool.
You
I take my
shirt
off.
Jump out of your birthday cake. I'm kidding. So the other dessert, very quickly at Trader Joe's, those little ice cream cones. They have a chocolate.
Oh, the hold the cone, right? You're
They're
talking about
so
the hold the cone. Here's the thing with the hold the cone. It should be hold two cones because you can't really hold. They're so little. You're gonna have to hold two because you're gonna eat two.
So good.
Yeah. And by the way, they have the non-dairy hold the cones versions.
They do?
Yeah, there's like a.
Is it good?
It's pretty good.
Oh, it is. Yeah. The chocolate chip, though, I've discovered is
chocolate
so
chip
good.
Is fantastic.
And the one thing you don't want to get that I it starts talking to me. We have no relationship
anymore.
The food
talks to you?
Don't talk to me anymore. Yeah, I walk by the aisle.
Do you answer the food?
I ignore
good.
It.
Excellent.
I said, don't ever talk to me again. I never talk to it again. It's the ice cream
so you
sandwich.
Do
I don't talk to it anymore. I did. I used to love it. We had a relationship.
Did a relationship.
It was a chocolate chip sandwich, ice cream sandwich, and around the outside, just like at Disneyland, chocolate chips. And when it starts to melt around the outside, do I sound like I'm hungry? Or I love dessert.
I'm
going
to go to yoga land right
after
this. I
feel passionate. Oh, it's so expensive for nothing. They give you nothing, and it's $7.
Back to the inflation.
It's ridiculous.
We were talking about,
oh, yeah, they
used
charged.
Used to be $3.
All right. Well, now you sound really old. But they did
wasn't
charge.
Wasn't that long ago?
Just like about a couple months ago. Yeah, they didn't charge for a side of extra dressing for your salad. They charged $1 for a little side of this little place in Beverly Hills.
Yeah,
I forgot the name of it.
Beverly Hills.
I got this tuna salad. And then I went to the gynecologist and I said, please tell the doctor it's not me. I'm eating a tuna salad.
I went for lunch in Beverly Hills. I won't even say the place. We had
David even catch on to what I said?
I'm just going
to
tell you. I had two Caesar salads, bread, which they charged us for. And somebody had another $75.
What?
And I went, can I see the bill? And they're like, yeah. Oh, the bread. You charge for the bread. Yes, we charge for the bread. Charges for bread. The salads, a couple of iced teas, and like someone had some meat thing, and that was $75.
Well, I wasn't trying to say it was expensive. I was saying that I went to the gynecologist today, and I was eating the salad while I was laying there in the stirrups. I was just at the gynecologist's office, and it was kind of a funny
scene. This is not an image
scene.
I'm going to be able to shake lately.
What? What would you say?
It's a difficult image for me right now.
The gynecologist?
Yes.
Oh, I was wearing a dress on top.
Wow.
And then I realized how weird that is because I lifted the dress because I don't want to have to take it off. And I put the sheet and I had my salad and then I put it away.
You eat when you're at the gynecologist?
Well, I was.
And there I got the stirrups?
Well, no. I did in the stirrups and everything. And then he came in and then I said, it's not me. It's the tuna salad, in case you wondered. I put it away.
You didn't think maybe not to bring the food in?
No.
To
what am I gonna, where am I going to put it? I was finishing it.
Well, there's things going on.
Not yet. Anyway, you have no idea what went on. But the point is that my dress was lifted to here.
Well.
And then I realized, this might look a little strange. Maybe I should have not
worn a dress.
Or worn a cape or whatever.
A cape?
It's like they call it a gown. They give you a gown. Yeah. But I was wearing, anyway, I was wearing a summer dress. Yeah, it was a little weird,
uh-huh.
just because.
It's a little weird.
It could be a weird, it could be a weird thing for the doctor to have me just pull the dress up.
Just weird listening to me.
I should have taken the whole thing off, I guess.
Wow.
Right?
Well,
and then
he would have liked that.
She...
Unless it was a she, maybe she would have liked that.
Oh, no, it's a him. I know, it's a little.
He definitely liked
normally
that.
Normally, I don't, I never would have wanted to go to a guy, but he's very good.
Okay. I'm really glad
he's the big guns.
Filled me in on what that experience is
yeah.
like.
Well, the tuna salad in the gynecologist's office was kind of...
Just, I can't even
it
imagine
was a wacky
having
day.
Food at a doctor's office.
I know. It was a wacky
any kind of doctor's.
But then
that
you know, they gave me after that lemon balls or what? Lemon heads?
What?
Lemon heads. They what? Had. I was like, oh.
The candy?
Is this from... Can I have this? Because I love these. It'll be in my book, ladies and gentlemen. That's chapter 12. It's taken a long time to write this book, David. I hope you read it.
I will definitely.
I'll be making it into a movie.
Excellent.
It'll be a comedy.
Well, this
very dark comedy. Did we hit on everything? We hit on all the desserts and everything.
I think we did.
I think we hit on everything. Gynecologist and all.
Most important is watch Place of Bones August 23rd.
Well, it's already passed.
Murder at Hollow Creek.
So now they can catch it everywhere.
Well, now it's just out.
Yeah.
Yeah, when does this... I don't even know when this podcast comes out.
Well, I shot 4 this week, so sorry I didn't study and watch all your episodes, but I shot 4 this week, so I'm going on vacation later, so I won't be around to shoot.
They'll still be on VOD.
I did research you, though.
Did you?
Yeah, that's how I found out you did plays.
I did. I did Glengarry Glen Ross, which was a Pulitzer Prize winning
You
play.
Did Glengarry Glen Ross!
Best thing I ever did, yeah.
Oh my god, what character did you
play? I played Moss, which Ed Harris played in the movie.
Oh my god, I love that's one of my favorites. It's right
favorite
over
play?
There on my shelf. Do you like Speed the Plow?
I love Speed the Plow.
I did Speed the Plow.
I'm a big Mammoth fan, so...
Oh yeah, I figured.
Yeah, I actually produced the play too.
You
of
did?
Yeah.
Was that in Canada or here?
Nope, here, West Hollywood. At the Mancha
oh
Theater
god.
On Kings Road.
Oh my god.
Yeah. We ran for 2 months in 2008.
What year was it? 2000? That's really strange. I'm going to read what... I have a picture over there with the cast that'll show you from Speed the Plow. I'll show you the year.
Oh, wow.
That might
yeah.
have been...
Tom Hanks and Rita Wilson came to the show.
Oh, you had
Stamos
good people.
Stamos came to the show.
Who?
Stamos.
Oh, okay.
John. All kinds of celebrities came.
It wasn't Scott Baio, it was John Stamos. Sometimes people get them mixed up. Sometimes.
No, I don't mix them up. I work with Stamos.
I'm joking. I'm saying something.
And I know Scott.
It's just a joke. This has gone completely off.
Well, you started this with
I'm
the
kidding.
Gynecologist.
This is kind
He's
of...
He's an oncologist, which makes
oncologist.
No sense.
He's the big guns.
Yeah, all right.
It's in the book, I
big
told
guns.
You.
Yeah.
He's got big guns, too. But we're not into guns. It's not Don't get political.
I gave Matt Rife that line for...
What was the line?
It was... He's like, well, we got nothing to worry about because I got these 2 guns.
Jesus.
It was really, you know, because he was that kind of character, so.
Well, he's still like that.
That was an ad lib
that
I think I gave him, yeah.
Okay. Well, then we'll have to do a comedy.
Yeah,
you know
he
Joel
does 50
Michael?
Push-ups before every take.
Oh, come on. Do you know Joel Michael?
I do.
I did a comedy one time, and a friend of mine didn't hire me to play a character, and it was to play a, like, TSA agent. And, Joel calls me and goes, this person is like doing the Oprah show suddenly or something. I'm not kidding. I need you here right now. Can you get here? What are you doing? I said, I'm just trying. He's like, just, I said, well, I need to shower. Don't shower. I'm like, well, what do you mean don't shower? Of course I'm going to shower. Get over here. Get over to the valley. I said, but what am I doing? He goes, just, you look great. Just get over here. Well, so I didn't wear a bra that was attractive. I wore, like, just a nude bra, right? Because just in case you don't know what you're wearing. Like, right now, same thing. You know, it's sheer. You don't want to see anything, so you wear a nude bra.
That's what I do.
Not cute when I'm playing the... So my friend didn't hire me. Joel did. Joel's like, do this. And I'm just like, do some crazy thing. He's like, this is hilarious. Oh, my God. And then the scene is that I have to rip my TSA shirt off and attack this, and I'm wearing this boring nude bra, but it's a really funny scene.
Just needed a sexier bra.
It's that would have been nice. And then he's supposed to be, and it gets a little, it's just, it's funny. We're supposed to be doing something inappropriate, and I'm wearing this thing. Not my dream way I want to be remembered in a movie is like wearing a nude bra. It's not cute.
For Shannon Elizabeth, I gotta tell
a
you.
A nude bra?
No, just nude.
No, it's a nude bra. Oh my god.
Just saying.
Anyway, it was really funny. But the fact is that Joel did that kind of thing where he was just like throwing out because it was
very
that
good.
Kind of crazy, funny little thing. Yeah. He is really funny. I know. We have a lot of friends in common. I didn't realize that.
Yeah.
Anyway, happy belated birthday,
Thank
by
you
the
very
way.
Much.
Sorry I missed you jumping out of your cake.
Yes, there was no cake to jump out of, but
there
I did jump
out of
the pool.
There was a big cake.
There
I saw pictures.
A lovely cake.
With your
with
face
on
it.
My partner, Bobby, his wife, got her hands on some photos from my parents and put it on a cake from when I was 14.
Are you serious?
I have to wish her a happy birthday, by the way.
That is so
before
bizarre.
I forget.
Well, this is the longest episode we've ever done.
Oh, my God. It's 120.
I know, but you've
put
just
the air
lost
on,
5 pounds. And,
it's a good way to lose weight.
And guess
what?
Now I didn't even eat dinner because the alarm probably went off and I missed
I can't
it.
The alarms.
So, anyway, don't eat. I'm kidding. All right, everybody. Now, here's the other thing we're going to do. We're going to do the quote of the week.
Quote of the week.
We're going to... Do you know a quote that you prefer that maybe you'd like to say?
Two roads diverged in the wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference.
That's not really a quote. Isn't that like a...
It's a poem.
Poem. It's okay. For the quote of the day, I'm going to pick one.
This right.
This is a strange one, and I don't know why. Okay, whatever. I'm going to read this one. It's Ernest Hemingway.
Well.
It takes 2 years to learn to speak, and 60 to learn to keep quiet. To learn to keep quiet.
Remember those words.
Everybody, thank you so much. Thank you for joining,
thank
David.
You. Thank
I'm
you
glad
for
that
me.
We got to know each other a little bit here.
In the sweatbox.
After all these years.
Yes.
Everybody, please, peace and love. Hey, don't forget to subscribe and like it if you liked it, but you don't want to miss it, so subscribe now. See you soon.